So now let us look at the 14th lecture on module 1. We have already solved a couple of examples to make you to understand how for a given idealized single degree freedom system. The moment I say idealized, originally the model is not a single degree, but you can always idealize. Idealization comes with equivalent stiffness, which we call as k bar, which is a lateral stiffness matrix. So I know single mass and therefore I get omega again. And this is only a method by which the idealization helps you to find out the approximate frequency of vibration of the system if it is idealized as a single degree freedom system. We will take up another example now where the problem is solved from the first principles back again. Let us see how this is done. Let us say I have a spring mass system like this. It is subjected to a load which is F naught, and F naught is an impulse function. On a time scale, the amplitude is F naught till Q from 0, and above Q for the infinite period there is no load. So the load is acting only for a small duration of 0 to Q. Beyond Q, for T greater than Q, load is 0. Okay, so there are two cases here. So I will split the problem into two parts. One is obviously 0 less than T less than Q to T greater than Q. And this is also true for T less than or equal to Q. For any value more than Q, then the function is very easy to remember. So let us try to answer this problem in two parts and see how this can be handled. So we know that equation of motion for this problem is very easy. F of T. We know the free vibration, sorry, the complementary function. Solution of this problem, which is x of t, which we know from the first principles is a cos omega n t omega n t, where a and b can be evaluated depending upon the initial conditions given to the problem. The initial conditions given are like this: at t equals 0, x 0 is 0, at t equals 0, x dot 0 is also 0. Let us say these are the conditions given in the problem. So the system does not have an initial displacement, initial velocity at t is equal to 0. So the particular integral for this, for the part of 0 less than t less than or equal to q, is going to be F naught by, let us say, m d square plus omega n square. Okay, that is what it is. So I can always say F naught as F naught e sin omega t and so on, or F naught simply e 0 t, a standard function. Therefore, I can say d square is 0. So I can do like this, which will be F naught by m omega n square d square by omega n square. Which will give me F0 by k of, I must put 0 here, therefore my pi will be F naught by k, therefore my x of t will be a cos omega n t plus b sin omega n t. Plus f0 by k. Now at t is equal to 0, x0 is 0, at t is equal to 0, x dot 0 is 0, get the values of a and b. Therefore, x of t can be known as, find out the values of a and b, it will be f0 by k. 1 minus cos omega n t for 0 less than t less than q. Is it okay? You can find a and b from this function, you will get this. Let us call this equation number 1, first part of the answer. This is only one segment of the answer, I have one more. Now for t greater than q, we know the right hand side of equation of motion is 0, there is no load. So therefore, only complementary function will be there, which is x of t, which will be given as c cos omega n t plus d sin omega n t, because only complementary function will be there, there is no pi. Now to evaluate c and d, which are constants of this particular equation, this requires initial condition from the first part, because at t equals q, velocity and displacements are not 0, okay? There are some values, so substitute those values. So let x of t, which is equal to f naught by k, 1 minus cos omega n t, be considered for t equals q. So x at q will be f0 by k, 1 minus cos omega in q. So I will call this equation number 2, this is of course equation number 3. Now from 2 I require xq and x dot q, because equation 2 is valid only for t greater than q. Xq already have here, x dot of q also I can find, because x of expression is there, I can differentiate this and substitute and get s dot q. Once I know that, substitute these conditions in the original equation and find x of t for the second part. Tell me, what is the second part x of t? So at t equals q, xq is f0 by k, 1 minus cos omega in q, x dot q, if you differentiate and substitute, you will get omega n f dot k sin omega, sorry. So substitute back and find the c and d constants. Then you will know that x of t will become, after evaluating c and d, f0 by k, 1 minus cos omega n q, which is borrowed from here, t minus q, plus that is the answer for the second part. So you can also solve the problem from the first principles like this to find out the solution of x of t, where an impulse function is applied for a short duration of 0 to q. Can divide the problem into two parts, and this function can be of any nature. It can be a function which is rectangular, it can be a triangular impulse, it can be an impulse of very short duration, which is called a Dirac delta function, which we'll talk about that slightly later, and so on and so forth. It can be a step function. So you should be able to solve the response of a single degree for a given RHS of equation of motion by dividing them into equal number of divisions as they are possible to find. Okay, that is the idea of this particular case. We will take one more example where I will take a 2 degree freedom system and derive k and m now quickly. Any doubt here? Is it clear? Take another example. So, a single bay 2 story frame which is fixed at the bottom. And a single bay 2 story frame which is fixed at the bottom. I am taking very simple examples to illustrate. In the second module you will pick up original structures of offshore, and you will know that how we can derive k and m for different kind of structures like a TLP, spar, etc. I will talk about that in the second module later, but let us first understand how to derive for simple problems. Let us say the height of the frame is about h meters. The width of the frame is about 2 h meters. In my figure it may not look proportionate, but this is how the dimensions are. And I have a lumped mass here which is equal to m. I have a lumped mass here which is equal to 2 m. Now we all know how to calculate this lumped mass in a given frame. It is nothing but the dimensions of the beam and column. Columns are taken up to half of this floor. So you know the length of the column or height of the column, you know the cross section dimension, you know the volume, you know the density, get the mass. Okay? And you know the slab, therefore you get the mass focused at this particular point, which is lumped at this area. Similarly, there are some additional mass given to this floor, therefore it is 2 m. Okay, just to differentiate this. And we say the frame is subjected to lateral loading, therefore I take the degrees of freedom in the lateral direction. Okay, now there is a very interesting question here. I will come to that question later. First let us draw the figure completely. Let us say stiffness of the column is k and this is 2k, this is 2k and k. So to realize this, how this happens, k is the bending stiffness in this case, because when you push the frame will bend. So you are looking for not the axial stiffness but the bending stiffness. So I should look for EI by L and not AE by L. Okay, in the last case we have explained that. So L is fixed in the problem, E is also fixed in the problem, or the entire material is almost common, okay, constant. The one which is causing more K should be the I. Okay, or unfortunately you can have a structure like this. You can have a structure like this also. Let us say L is phenomenally high, which also changes k, okay, which is not realistic because you will not see a structure like this. More or less the height will be almost equal, but in certain cases the bottom floor height can be higher because of some specific requirements of functionality, okay, but you will not find this. Therefore, the major variable in k or the stiffness of the member will be essentially should come from I. Sometimes rarely comes from L or H, but never from E. Okay. Therefore, the practical case is these columns are having more stiffness. It means the cross section dimensions of this column are larger compared to this. Okay. That is how you get more K at the bottom floors and you get less K at the top floors. Ideally speaking, the same column should go through and through, so KK. But sometimes the K can vary because you have a higher loading in the bottom floor, therefore the columns can be of a larger dimension, whereas as it goes up and higher, the column dimensions can be lower than this, okay, and therefore this is a realistic problem. Now there is a very interesting case here. See, generally in spring mass system, you will notice that we always mark the degrees of freedom in the direction as that of the restoring capacity of the spring. For example, I have never marked x as a theta in the problem, because spring does not oscillate. Spring can only extend laterally or vertically in this particular case. It means the degrees of freedom are generally marked in the problem to match to the restoring capacity of the restoration component of the system. Whereas in this case, if I think that these springs are all of the same nature, my x1 and x2 should have been vertical, okay, but I am marking x1 and x2 in a lateral. It means I say the response of the system is proportional to the force coming on the system, okay. So the force is pushing the system to the right, therefore the response should always obviously on the right. But is there any mismatch of the concept that if the degree of freedom is in the same fashion as that of the restoring component, it restores. But now where is the restoration here? Because it is only pushing, it is not pulling, or it is only pushing to the side. So it is, the answer is very clear here. I am talking about this member which is having a bending stiffness. I talked about this member which had an axial stiffness. So it depends on your degrees of freedom is depend on the manner in which the restoration will happen. In this case, it is going to bend back and restore. So I am talking about bending stiffness. So in these problems, bending stiffness should be invoked and not the lateral stiffness, okay. So do not get confused that we are not marking the degrees of freedom in the same fashion as that of the previous spring mass idealized examples, okay. Now the basic question here is I must derive the mass matrix and stiffness matrix. Mass are lumped. The moment I say mass are lumped and the degrees of freedom are applied to the same point where the mass is lumped, then I can simply say the mass matrix will be a diagonally dominant leading element, all ordinary elements will be 0. But it is not the case all the time. I will show you next example where this distance happened, okay. But in this case it is easy to write, first degree 2m, second degree m. On the other hand, if this should have been m and this is 2m, I would change this as m and 2m, no problem. So mass matrix can be written instantaneously for a given problem, provided we can mark the degrees of freedom correctly at the point where mass is lumped. If the degrees of freedom are marked at a different point where the mass is not lumped, then the mass component at this point should be worked out, which I will do in the next problem, okay. So carefully choose the points where you want to measure the displacements. Usually it is a practice to measure displacements at flow level, but not a guarantee that you need not have to measure the displacement in the middle of the column. You can always, okay. Therefore, it is always idealistic for an engineer to understand mass lumped at the floor. And interestingly, I have not marked x3 here, because it is all evident for people that x3 will have no movement because it is fixed, okay. And I would have marked theta 1, but I am not marking. So you must choose the degree of freedom in such a manner which will explain the response of the system in the most simplest form. So do not create complication in choosing degree of freedom, because this will add or this will initiate complication through and through the problem. In dynamics, make the choice of degrees of freedom at the simplest. It should give me the physical representation of the response of the system for the given force. Now one may ask me a question, sir, the force also acting downward, which is the self weight of the structure. Why we do not have degrees of freedom along self weight? Why here? Okay. So the self-weight of the structure will not have response because the structure is so rigid in terms of its response, whereas the lateral motion of the structure will be highly flexible. So you have to also choose which degrees of freedom will be important for the given system, which you have got to trace in the dynamic analysis, okay. So choice of the degree of freedom is yours. The moment you choose that, ideally and intelligently lump the mass at those points to make the, at least the mass matrix happy. The stiffness matrix will not be happy, okay. We will see how it can be derived from the first principles again, right. So let us derive the mass matrix. Now I want to derive stiffness matrix. We already know the coefficient of stiffness matrix is like this. It is nothing but the force at ith freedom by giving unit displacement of the jth freedom or degree of freedom, keeping all of the degrees of freedom restrained. That is the standard. So stiffness is nothing but the force which is responsible to cause unit displacement in the other degree, correct, keeping all of the degrees as 10. So stiffness matrix in this case is going to be 2 by 2 because I have got 2 degrees of freedom. So I will be generating or deriving K11, K21, K12, K22. Row first, column next. Okay? You have to follow this like a nursery child. You must have seen in nursery classes, people used to write A, B, C, D in square pages. A, B, C. If you write D, teacher will scratch and say, write D like this. Now, you may wonder that why this practice was given. Now, you see in all international practice, where you have been asked to write, you are always given a coded like this only. Have you ever seen a form where you write your name like this? Then people will write starting like this also. Wherever there is a coding available, you will have to also write only in a form of a matrix. Is given to you. And they will also write here, please legibly write within the squares. They will tell you to do this. Okay? It is easy to recognize. Similarly, you have to have a mechanism by which you read the stiffness matrix. Row first, column next. Row first, column next. So you must have this practice all the time. So I am going to derive this column wise. So I want to give you a displacement at 1 and find the forces at 1 and 2. Let us do that. You may wonder that why we are emphasizing on derivation of stiffness matrix all the time. We already know this. Can anybody answer this question? Why do we insist on deriving stiffness matrix all the time in these examples? It has got a very, very valid answer. Very simple, straightforward answer. It is there. I have already told you n number of times in the class. Sorry? Yeah, button may be right or wrong, does not matter.
So, the structure is eccentric capacity?
No.
Finding the omega in natural
frequency? No. My question is very simple. You are going ahead. I am in the bottom. I am asking you in my examples, why I insist on deriving a stiffness matrix. I can write the stiffness matrix directly. My job is to find omega n only. Why I am insisting on derivation of stiffness matrix and mass matrix? Why? Sorry?
Equivalent stiffness.
What is that?
Equivalent stiffness conversion.
Equivalent stiffness conversion. No. No.
There is a basic something.
No. The essential characteristic of dynamic system is only mass and stiffness. If you cannot derive these matrices for a given system, probably you cannot do dynamic analysis at all. You may know them, so you will wait for somebody to give you this. The moment somebody gives you this, you proceed further. But who will give you this? Nobody. You have got to derive. There are special problems in ocean structures where you will generate your own form for which you are the boss. Nobody is going to tell you where are the degrees of freedom, what are the stiffness derivations, nobody, nothing is available in the literature. You have got to start from the scratch. So we are starting from all the problems from the scratch. And I will adopt the same principle to derive stiffness matrix for TLP, SPAR, Triceratop, FSRU, total in the second module. So you will know how it has been derived from the first principles. Once you know those examples very clearly done, you can derive stiffness matrix and mass matrix by any form of your choice in research. Okay? That is the reason why we are deriving the stiffness matrix. It may look easy for you, but still, I will draw this column. This is the point. I am just marking the points. I should give unit displacement in the direction as that of the force. Okay? This is the deflector configuration because both ends are fixed. I said all the joints are always fixed and we already know this. When you move it, there is always a tendency for the structure to bring it back. We already marked this. Similarly, this way and this way. Okay? And this was 6 EI delta by L square. That is a standard expression. As I apply this to this problem, it is 6 E 2i delta is 1 by h square. So, 12 vi by h square, can I write like this? So, this is also 12 vi by h square. This will be again 6 ei delta by l square, which is 6 ei delta. I is only 1 because there is only 1 k, That is why I said k is dependent on I, not on L, divided by h square. So it is going to be 6 ei by h square, 6 ei by h square. Okay. Now I want to, these are the moments. I do not have any degree of freedom in the moments. I have degrees of freedom only in the lateral dimensions. So I must convert them into equivalent forces, because stiffness is nothing but the force for unit displacement. Force along one and along two. So I must find the reaction. So this is an anti-clockwise couple. So I must have a couple of this order, which is clockwise, because this is anti-clockwise. So 12 plus 12, 24. So this is going to be 24 EI by H square by H. That is why I do the couple. Okay. I can simply say this 24 EI by H cube. Then this is also going to be 24 EI by H cube. Okay. Let us go to the top one, this one. So couple of 6 plus 6, 12. Therefore, strictly speaking, I should mark the arrow here at this joint, but there is no space, I am marking it here. Okay. So it is going to be 12 EI by H square of 1 by H, which can be 12 EI by H cube, is also 12 EI by H cube. The arrow, because this is clockwise, it has got to be anti-clockwise. Okay. Okay. I have to do similarly for the other column also, because there are two columns. So now I can cite K11, the force in the first degree for unit displacement given in the first degree itself will be the yellow one and the orange one, both of them in the same direction. So 24 plus 12, 36. Into 2, because there are two columns. Okay. If there are n columns, into n. So this 2 represents number of columns. Okay. Whereas K21, row first, column next, stiffness matrix always derived column wise. Okay. I am looking for this element now. I have already have this element with me. Okay. I must look here. The direction is towards right, my force is towards left, so minus. Okay. Into of course 2, this 2 is because of 2 columns. Similarly, I can draw for the next column. For the next degree, I must give unit displacement as delta equals 1. The deflector profile is going to be like this. We know that it will create a moment of this order. Since this segment of the column is not, or this column is not deflecting, there is no moment required for this column to restore it. Okay. So this is going to be again 6 EI delta by L square, that is a standard expression. Let us substitute this for here, which is going to be 6 E I, because there is only 1 K, that is only 1 K into delta is unity by H square. So this is also going to be 6 E I by H square. But I do not have moments as my degrees of freedom, I have only forces towards right as degrees of freedom. Let me convert this into forces. This is anti-clockwise, so I can make it a couple of clockwise, which will be 12 EI, because 6 and 6, 12 EI by H cube and 12 EI by H cube. Okay. So I should write now K12 and K22. I am deriving the second column okay. I am deriving now these two elements. So, K12, I should look at this object here towards right, my force is towards left. So, minus 12 EI by HQ of 2 columns. Similarly, K22, I must look at this point, I should look here towards right. So, positive 12 EI by HQ of 2 columns. I can now write the stiffness matrix here. Let us take EI by HQ 24 as a multiplier, because you see this is 72, this is 24, 24 and 24, I take 24 out, okay. This is stiffness matrix now, okay. So, I have my K, I have my M, I can easily find omega. Now, the question is, if omega and K and M are 2 by 2, you get 2 omegas and 2 phis, okay. We will solve this problem probably after a couple of examples more. We will retain the solution with us, we will have the same K and say M back again, we will solve omega and phi separately, which are eigen characteristics of this problem, okay. Ideally, one can ask me a question, sir, can I convert this to a K bar or K equivalent and find omega n? If that is the case, you must also have M bar. Now, there are two M's here. In the previous example, if you turn back, there was only one M, okay. So, M relates to the degree of freedom actually indirectly. So, that idealization was possible, but in this case, it is not possible because K bar will not help you because M is a 2 by 2 matrix. So, I have got to solve this omega and phi separately, which I will do later, okay, because I need more examples to understand this. Then I will make you to the next transformation, how to find omega n for a given problem. We will do that. So, now the problem stops here apparently, that I have got K and M here. How to proceed further, how to get x of t, we will talk about that later, but now we understand how to get K. So, please understand, the derivation of stiffness matrix is not for any specific problem, but it is independent of the problem. Water may be your form, procedure is same. You look back all the examples, water may be the form, procedure to get K is same. That is the beauty of the stiffness matrix in analysis, but I am using that advantage for dynamics, okay. So, one must strictly follow how to derive stiffness matrix for a given system from first principles. Give unit displacement, get the force. If you understand this strongly, any form you have, you can easily derive the stiffness matrix easily. So, you are not stuck up with the research in the beginning, okay. Now, interestingly, if you have modeled this in any software for a numerical analysis, the numerical analysis also give you K, okay. If you know by hand how to derive K, you can always check whether the K given with the software or whether the K taken forward with the software to find omega n is correct or wrong. Therefore, you will know whether the omega n calculated with the software is correct or wrong. If you have no clue how to get K, you have to depend on omega n given with the software, which may be wrong also. Sometimes you will notice, if you do not model it properly, your omega n will become, I mean, phenomenally wrong, okay. Your whole interpretation will start from omega n onwards. Therefore, your whole design or analysis can go divergently wrong. It all happened because you do not know how to derive K from the first principles. You are always dependent on making the model efficiently, but not to work out K by hand, okay. The procedure is common. It is not problem specific, it is unique and it is common to all the problems in the same manner. So, once you follow this, it is very easy for me to derive K, whatever may be the geometry what I want to derive K for, okay. That is what the point of insistence is here. So, we will do quickly one exercise problem for you, let us see how many of you can do it. Already we have done this, but just I am giving you this problem for you to solve. what I want is the equations of motion. So it's going to be 2 by 2 in the matrix form. That is the first question I want. The second question is, suppose if I change this as x1 and this as x2, will the equation of motion remain same? That is the second question. I want answers for both the questions in 5 minutes. So I can start helping you just to mark. So k of x1, 2k of x1 minus x2, k of x2, of course this is m and this is 2m, and this will have a force of m x1 double dot, this will have a force of 2m x2 double dot. Now you have the Newton's law applied here, you can easily write the equation of motion and check. I want to tell you a very important point which generally will cause confusion. Please note here, this is very important. This is very important. This is a very classical trick in writing equation of motion. Please notice the directions here. Okay, notice the directions. Generally, if you open any literature or textbook which writes equation of motion, they write like this. Okay, now there is no confusion at this point and at this point, there is no confusion. The confusion is only here. See the arrows here, see the arrows here. Apparently when you look these two, you will always get an instantaneous feeling that this is wrong and that is right, because there is a symmetry. If you look closely, both of them are having the same answer, because this is 2k x1 minus x2 towards left. This is towards again left, but x2 minus x1. If you put a minus sign here, it will become automatically like this. Okay, so don't get confused and don't follow kindly this. Okay, don't follow this. Follow only this. I will explain how this has come. Again, I push the mass towards right, the spring will bring it back. So kx1. When I push the mass towards right, this spring will push the mass back. So 2k. Write the first coordinate of where are you applying, write the second coordinate where it is connected. Similarly, look at this mass, 2m moves right, so this will move towards left because it is throwing 2k of x2 minus x1. And when you push this, this spring will push back, there is no relative movement here, so only k of x2. It is very, very easy to understand, very easy. So do not be carried away by this and don't try to think yourself that okay, I will do problems in both ways. You will end up in miss. Follow only one. It is easy. Okay, you can easily find the, I think from this you can easily write the M and K matrices easily. And I want your answer on the second part of the problem. If I change x1 to x2 or I swap the coordinates, let the mass remain same, no problem, but I want to swap the coordinates. Will equation of motion change? Okay, so please try to answer this as an exercise problem yourself and try to tell me what is their idea or what is their observation on these kinds of problems. Also try to solve this problem using energy method and see whether the equation of motion are getting compared. Any doubts, any questions here? Thank you very much.